Jakob, daginn. Velkomin á þennan fyrirlestur með IoT. Hann Martin mun fara aðeins yfir hérna Azure IoT með ykkur og svona sjá hvað kostir eru í því að nýta sér lausnir innan Azure fyrir IoT. Þannig að ég ætla að gefa honum orðið. Hello Martin and thanks for joining us and giving us your time for this topic. I'll just give you the word now and good luck.
All right, thank you very much, Isli. I'm gonna try and share my screen. This is the most exciting part of what we're gonna do right now. Let's see, I wanna share my entire desktop, but it has to be hopefully screen number two. There we go. Hopefully you can see my screen right now. It should just be an empty desktop. So let me start my slides here and let me also show.
You're muted. Næstan að dotta út. Sjáum hvort að dotta þrunina til smá stund. You okay?
Yeah, I got disconnected somehow, so at least I could reconnect pretty fast. So let's call this a false start and let's try this again. And this time hopefully better. You should again see my desktop, hopefully. I'm going to start my slide deck right now and we're going to go into presentation mode so we can see something. I also will show myself a little bit. That's probably nicer than you know who you're dealing with. So hopefully at some point I will appear in the screen as well. Let me see, let that set up properly. Well, I wish I had. We need to do that screen sharing one more time just to be on the safe side.
I can see your, I can see your presentation.
Yeah, I don't want to have that there actually. I need to stop that presentation again. Okay, better. Then I need to move this to go always to my primary monitor. Now I need to start it again. If I mastered PowerPoint well, that would be really good actually. Let's see, I'm gonna go back to presentation mode. Now I'm here. This is so much better, except for it's not, because now we have that again. Oh man, leave that entirely. I'm promising that this is not going to be part of, you know, like the actual presentation. I'm going to give you everything that we want to show. Actually, I didn't want to have presenter view there. So now if I do this again, it should work properly. And there we go, finally. And now I should be able to get myself in there as well. So hello, here am I presenting to you from the Netherlands. My name is Maarten Struijs. I'm an IoT solution architect here at Microsoft. And I want to talk about the Internet of Things. I'm going to try and speak not too fast. Although I know myself, probably I will hurry up, you know, like when I really get excited. I'm going to talk about IoT in general and why we think IoT is so important for our business and how you can transform your business using IoT. But IoT is not something that stands alone. IoT is, you know, like it's a collection name of things being connected to the internet, but we don't want to do connect things just because for fun or something. We want to connect those things to, you know, like solve business problems or get, you know, like better value for our customers, things like that. And that's what in the upcoming 45 minutes or so I want to share with you. Also, I want to share at least, you know, like a little demonstration where we're going to build an IoT solution from scratch. Well, if you look at IoT solutions and where we are active building those solutions, then it's in lots of different industry verticals. So for instance, in manufacturing, you find a lot of IoT, very, very important and relevant these days. It's in the energy market where, you know, like we want to be very, you know, careful using energy, making sure that, you know, like we have reduction of CO2 and things like that. And IoT can help there as well. Smart cities, another example, things like offices that are, you know, like kind of changing, you know, like we want to, you know, like make sure that the temperature in a meeting room is comfortable, but only if that meeting room is used, for instance, and IoT can help there as well. Transportation, healthcare, of course, a very, very actual theme right now with the whole COVID-19 situation, where we build, you know, like lots of devices that help monitoring our health. Now, if you look from a very high level, an IoT solution used to be, you know, like lots of things that got connected to the cloud, and those devices were sending data to the cloud, and inside the cloud, we were doing all kinds of smart things with that data. But over the years, our vision has changed a little bit. We still have an intelligent cloud and we have devices at the edge. But more and more often, what you see is that we also need to make decisions at the edge. For instance, if I would build a self-driving car and I would need to continuously go to the cloud to make a decision whether or not to, you know, like drive straight or go to the left or to the right or something. Well, if I would do that over a network connection, that would be pretty bad because it takes time, you know, like to get to the cloud and get some information back. And the decision in a self-driving car to, you know, like go to the left, you know, like to turn to another street or something, is one that needs to be done in near real time. So that's something you want to purely do at the edge itself. And now we offer solutions for the intelligent edge and for intelligent cloud. The collection, the larger collection name of those solutions is actually IoT, but more and more you see edge computing coming into play as well, where, you know, like we can run various versions of specific Windows versions, for instance, to run on edge computers, and then have those versions of an edge device actually run the same workloads in little containers that we developed inside the Azure cloud. And that is the basis for something completely different called artificial intelligence. So at the basis of artificial intelligence, we still have IoT solutions. Gathering data, collecting data, and then in an AI solution, we kind of use all that data to make informed and smart decisions on what to do next and how to improve business processes, for instance. And then the next generation, and that's where we are at right now, is this thing called a digital twin, which is a digital representation of physical objects. And those objects can be little sensors, but they can also be as big as, for instance, you know, like a whole city or a whole building. And we can monitor what's going on inside that building, but also using these digital representations of those buildings, for instance, we can predict the future and what's going to happen with that building if all of a sudden, you know, like the occupancy of the building doubles or something. That could be true for cities as well, with traffic, for instance, or production factories. So IoT is not something that we see standalone, and just IoT is not that exciting. I mean, sending sensor data to the cloud is something that we've done for, you know, like over the last 40 years or something. Now, the way we are doing it is getting easier and we're getting better at it. But it's like when you get into an intelligent environment, so combining lots of different sensors and having all those sensors in a building, you know, being part of a larger system, maybe, you know, an automation system inside a building, that's where we get smart and that's where we build like real cool solutions. And even further, we can do that to, you know, to automate entire cities, for instance, you know, like, or entire countries, if you wish, all with, you know, like the idea in mind that, hey, if we can be more efficient in running our business, and efficiency can be like, hey, we can, you know, like run our business faster or maybe more energy friendly or something. That's where we're going to. And for that, we need a combination of cloud and edge solutions. So these, again, are the industry verticals in which we are active and for which we have services, not just in, you know, like the Azure IoT services or in cloud services, but also on intelligent edge devices and with intelligent sensors that are running at the edge. If I map this to what we have in our Azure IoT product portfolio, then what you will see is that, hey, we cover all these different industry verticals and we have a number of solutions for those industry verticals. Starting at the highest level, we have this product called Azure IoT Central. This basically is an application environment that allows to very easily and quickly build IoT solutions. You can also start from scratch yourself using all these underlying IoT services to build your own IoT solution. And again, I can't say that enough, but you want to have an IoT solution to solve a problem. You're not just connecting devices because you can connect devices, but, you know, like, I'm connecting devices because I want, for instance, the climate in my home office here being regulated better, more efficient, and not wasting energy. So that's my business problem that I want to solve here, you know, like if I would build a climate system for my home office, for instance. I can build it from scratch, what I said, using all these individual services that are dedicated for IoT usage, or I can use, you know, like all these services tied together by us, or I can start with an IoT reference architecture, which basically is a way to connect these services in such a way that they are scalable, that, you know, like if I start with few devices, but end up, you know, like with millions of devices, that the system doesn't come to a standstill because I couldn't scale it. We can also connect IoT solutions to backend systems like Dynamics 365, for instance. And that's important as well, because again, we don't want to build IoT solutions unless we want to solve some business problems. In order to solve those business problems, probably we need to know what's going on inside our business as well. We need to make sure that we have enough inventory, for instance, to build products. Well, Dynamics can help there. Or we need, you know, like if it's the case of servicing a system, let's say an elevator or something, we need to schedule the time of the service engineer to visit that physical elevator. And that's one of the other cool things with IoT solutions. What we can do with an IoT solution in combination with a little bit of artificial intelligence is do things like predictive maintenance, which means that, hey, usually until today, usually, for instance, for elevators, but also for maybe city lights or something, or traffic lights, usually what we did with those types of systems was sent, you know, like yearly a service engineer to service that particular device. With predictive maintenance, we can limit the amount of visits a service engineer has to do to visit that particular device, because we're going to predict when a device starts failing. And that brings whole different ways of thinking about business. One example, for instance, here is Rolls-Royce as an engine manufacturer for airplanes. What they can do right now, because they are so good at predictive maintenance, they can actually sell their engines as a service to an airline company. And so the airline company only pays, or the airliner only pays for the usage of the engine, and Rolls-Royce schedules mandatory maintenance for that particular engine only when it's absolutely necessary. And that doesn't give less safety. As a matter of fact, it gives more safety because we're continuously monitoring those types of devices. So we have many different services, and I'm not going to go into detail what all these services are, but later on we're going to talk about a reference architecture. I'm going to point out a few of these Azure services for IoT in a little bit more detail. On the edge, since what I said, edge computing is very important in combination with IoT solutions. We have also, you know, like operating systems for edge devices. We have a secure solution for microcontrollers being called Azure Sphere. And we have SDKs that application developers can use to actually develop applications for those edge devices. Now, I've been speaking for 10 minutes and mainly about, you know, like roughly what IoT is all about. And essentially, IoT is really easy as a concept to understand. We have things, those things gather data. We send that data to the cloud where we get insights from that data. And those insights will lead to a number of different actions that we're going to execute. So that's the most basic, simple way of looking at an IoT solution. In reality, those IoT solutions can become very, very complex because all those things might communicate through different protocols. Some of them can directly connect to the cloud, so they are IP or internet protocol capable. Some others might need a gateway. You might also want to have legacy devices connected to the cloud, for instance. Those legacy devices might only understand different data protocols that we, you know, like that are 30 years old and that we don't support anymore. So we need to come up with solutions for that. If you look at insights, how do we get insights from our data? Well, do we need to do that real time? Do we need to store that data? Do we need instant access to that data? Or if it's okay to, you know, like have that data available, but maybe in more of an archive type of way? And how are we going to take actions? How are we going to visualize what actions we are taking? How are we going to deal, for instance, with, you know, like updating firmware on devices that are part of an IoT solution? So at the end of the day, when you think about implementing your IoT solution, all of a sudden it can become very complex. A couple of things, and this slide is a little bit outdated, but at the same time, it's still very, very relevant. We recognized a number of attributes to which a IoT solution may needs to, you know, like commit in order to be completely scalable, in order to be able to manage different devices, in order to analyze data, in order to bring down the total costs of ownership. So if you go to this link here, aka.ms8attributes, you find a nice description of all these different properties that are absolutely necessary to build successful IoT systems. Scalability is one that, you know, like we often overlook, because when we are building a proof of concept using one or two sensors, connect them, you know, like to the cloud, then we quickly assume like, hey, this solution works, but what if we have 100 million devices that needs to be connected? Maybe all those devices need some sort of credentials in order to connect to the cloud. Well, if you don't automate that, you know, like for one or two devices, I can enter credentials manually, for instance, but with millions of devices, that's going to be very, very difficult and impossible. So you need to think about scalability before you're even starting building a system. We definitely need to think about security. As a matter of fact, once we are going to build a solution, the first thing we need to think about is security. Are our devices secure? Can somebody steal the identity of an IoT device? Because if that is true, then, you know, like you can easily get into very, very dangerous situations. So security is always a very, very important part in IoT solutions as well. Now, you have a couple of options for building IoT solutions. you can build that solution or those solutions from the ground up. And here's an example of that. If I want to build my solution from the ground up, then here I have my things. Of course, I design with security in mind, and I have some actions that I'm going to take. In the middle are my insights, and those insights are typically stored in the cloud, in Azure IoT services. At the heart of that is a thing called IoT Hub. An IoT Hub, if you wish, is the cloud gateway or the cloud entry point for all those different IoT devices. Around IoT Hub, I just showed a number of services here. There's a service called Azure Stream Analytics that can be used for real-time analyzing the stream of data that is coming from the IoT Hub, and the IoT Hub gets that data from different devices. I can store all that data in a SQL database. I can trigger functions to do some actions. Maybe, you know, like I have a temperature sensor that gives me temperature in Fahrenheit, but I need to have that temperature in Celsius. Well, then I can trigger a function to convert, you know, like a value from Fahrenheit to Celsius, for instance. I can use maps to display my location, especially useful if I have moving devices, etc., etc. Now, building an IoT solution means connecting all these services and connecting the right services properly to each other. And that's what can become complex. Now, we have a reference architecture of how, you know, like a generic IoT solution in our vision looks like. Here I have all those things, devices. They are connected to an IoT hub. And from that IoT hub, we're going to analyze the data. Once we have analyzed the data, we're going to use, you know, like maybe Power BI to report that data to a user. We can integrate with business logic, depending on the business, you know, like this could be different types of applications that are already in use inside a company. We want to store that data, maybe in a code path for machine learning purposes and for other AI workloads, where the data does not have to be instantly available, but we want to have all data, you know, like, and we want to be able to access all data. We also probably want to have a warm path store where, you know, like the data that is coming in is immediately available for taking actions. So this is a high level overview of an IoT solution. And then maybe for identity management, who has the right to use parts of the system, we can also use Azure Active Directory. But still, I have quite some moving parts here. So this is a rather complex reference architecture even. So let's show it again, and let's have those services around it. But typically, those services need to be managed as well. So maybe I need some Kubernetes service to, you know, orchestrate containers that I'm using. If I'm using containers, I probably need a container registry. I might need virtual machines. I might need, you know, like things like a key vault to securely store secrets. So it's not just those basic IoT services that we are needing, but we need lots and lots of other different services around it as well. And all of a sudden, that IoT solution becomes a pretty complex solution. So if you look at the maturity model of an IoT solution, it's like, hey, connecting devices, well, we don't need too much knowledge in order to do that. That's a relatively simple action, as long as we speak a protocol that is understood by our IoT hub. Monitoring data, not that difficult either. Analysis of data and improving our business model, for that we need a little bit more knowledge. We need to understand how all those different IoT solution services relate to each other and how to connect them and how to scale them. And if we want to really create different new business opportunities, then we need to be, you know, like at a more mature level of knowledge and have a clear understanding what all those different IoT services are doing. So if you want to build something from scratch, that's the basic message. You need to invest in quite some knowledge and you need to understand quite a lot of services. But there's another way in order to do that, because, you know, like as Microsoft, we are busy to simplify IoT solutions continuously. So in order to, you know, like get started with a very scalable solution, instead of using all these individual services, we can combine them for you in a product called Azure IoT Central. And Azure IoT Central is our IoT application platform that allows to very, very easy start building an IoT solution, connect devices. It's a highly secure solution. You cannot just connect any device. So you need to, you know, the devices need to have a proper key in order to communicate to this IoT app platform. But it's also a high available solution. So if one service in one data center stops working, we automatically transfer your workload to another data center and you don't even notice that something happened there. If you want to set up things like that yourself, you know, like solutions like that yourself, probably it's going to take you a couple of months in order to build a solution. With an IoT Central solution, as I will prove within the next 5 minutes or so, it can literally, for a proof of concept, take you less than 10 minutes to get up and running. We are using, you know, like all kinds of modern features here of Azure IoT. Inside one of those IoT Central applications, we are using a thing called Azure IoT Plug and Play, which allows us to have devices transmitting their capabilities to this IoT Central application. So a device could say like, hey, I am a sensor and I'm very good at measuring temperatures. When I send you temperatures, I send them in Celsius and I send them each 10 seconds, for instance, or something like that. By describing a device in those types of, let's say, telemetry messages that IoT Central understands, it's going to be very, very easy to connect different devices to an IoT Central application. And the underlying mechanism that we're using for that is all JSON-based, and we're using our digital twin definition language to define devices. So a device has a physical presence, but also, you know, like a digital presence in which the entire device is described. All these different, if I go back to that a maturity model for IoT solutions, then Azure IoT Central applications are, you know, like really good at monitoring and connecting devices and to improve and analyze the behavior of solutions. If we want to do more, if you want to build, you know, like complex AI models, then you can use the data that we collected inside an IoT Central application and we can export that to some data analytics functions. The advantage now is that all these 30 plus services that make up an IoT Central application are, for me, let's say, you know, like under the cover. I don't really have to understand how those services work. I only need to understand how to connect devices and how to export that data. Everything in between here is being taken care of for me. So, these were many, many words, and what I want to do now is at least show an IoT Central application in action. So in order to do that, I'm going to go back to my desktop. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go to my Azure IoT Central environment. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a new application. I have a couple of applications here already, but I'm going to start from scratch with a brand new application. And what you can see here is that, hey, I can create applications for a number of industry verticals. I can create an energy IoT solution or a healthcare one or a custom one. For now, I'm going to create a custom application and I'm going to call this Iceland demo. And this is a custom application, as I said, and you get immediately some indications for pricing. And what I want to do is I'm going to take this standard 2 solution. Inside this solution, I will get 2 devices that I can connect for free. And they will be for free for always. So if you have a rather large proof of concept or a long lasting proof of concept you want to run, you can do that easily with, you know, like as long as you limit yourself to 2 devices, you don't even have to pay for that. I need to select an Azure subscription, and I need to select a geographical location where I'm located, which is Western Europe. And what I'm now going to do is I'm going to create a brand new application, an IoT Central application. This is going to take a few seconds. But not much more than that. And here is my newly created application. Now, this application doesn't do much right now. For instance, I don't have devices inside my application. So the first thing I need to do probably is create a device template, a new device template for an IoT device. Now, if you recall, a couple of minutes ago, I was talking about IoT plug and play. And here in this list of featured device templates, you find all kinds of certified IoT plug and play devices. Every device that has a headline IoT plug and play is a certified device that connects automatically to an IoT Central application as long as you have the credentials for that IoT Central application. So the device needs to understand to which application it needs to connect. Once it knows that, then that device will automatically show up as a device in this particular solution, even with a little user interface in it. And then you as a solution builder can, you know, like modify that particular application a little bit. Now, I wanted to make it a little bit more exciting, so I'm going to create my own IoT device here from a custom template. If I would do that, then I can customize entirely this particular device. I can specify a template name, and I can indicate that it's a gateway device or it's not a gateway device. But hey, instead of building this myself, I can make this even simpler. So if I go back to here, I still have an empty list here. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you a little device. And that little device is coming up right now. This is an MX chip device, and this device is IoT plug and play capable. It's a nice little device, you know, like if you want to do a proof of concept. It has a little LCD display on it. It has a temperature sensor, a couple of other sensors. So what I want to do is I want to use this device in this brand new application that I created. And in order to do that, I need some credentials to allow my device to connect to this application. For that, I go to this device connection page, and I want to connect an IoT device. Now, in order to do that, I need to inject the firmware of the device with a few secrets. I need this ID scope. This is an indication of my IoT Central application. I'm going to put that right now in the device firmware. So I just copy that value in there. My device will be identified as being an MX chip with the following prefix MST01. And I also need to be able to securely access that device by using a shared access signature. Now I'm going to copy this value here. And now I need to make an individual product key or access key for my device. My device was called MXChip MST01, and I'm going to compute a secure access key for that device. Usually this is something that would have been done in the factory where the device is manufactured, and then this would have been baked into, you know, like ROM, or it would have been stored in a secure chip. But for now, I'm just adding this to source code. So this is something, you know, like typically you wouldn't do that, but for demonstration purposes, this is the easiest way to, you know, like be able to connect that device later on. So I'm going to add the security key inside my device. And now the next thing I need to do is rebuild my firmware because I just changed the firmware on my device. So I'm just going to rebuild my firmware of that device, which is done right now. And again, this is something typically you would not have to do that if you are using devices that some OEM manufacturers for you. Then you just give them those credentials and they bake it in into a security module on the device typically. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch on the device and then we need to copy the firmware to the device. So first I'm going to switch on my device, which just happened right now. And now copying the firmware to that device, that's going to be a very, very simple action. Because the device just shows itself here as a little flash drive. And what I'm going to do is from my application that I just created, because it's 1334 here in the Netherlands, I'm going to copy that firmware to that device here. And you can see a little LED flashing on the device indicating that the device is now being flashed with new firmware. Then at some point, hopefully we have a data connection once this is done. The device will reboot right now. The device is rebooting. And what you see now is that SMTP is initialized. So the device is now going to try and connect to an Azure IoT Central application. We're going to give the device a little bit of time. And now it indicates that, hey, we are connected to an Azure IoT solution. If I now go back to this particular demo that I created, and if I refresh my device templates thing, all of a sudden now you see that, hey, I have a brand new device getting started guide template. This template identifies all the telemetry data that I'm sending to the IoT Central application. And at the same time, it also has some commands that I can send to the application. So this is a full description of this particular device that you can see here, but then as digital twin for that device. It defines all telemetry. It also defines all commands that I can send to the device. And we also have a little user interface automatically being created for us already. The user interface has an overview and you can see it starts collecting data already from the device. I can also send a command to the device and let me, for instance, switch on an LED on the device. Now it's going to be a little bit hard to see because of the filters that I'm using to display this, but here at this location here are a couple of LEDs. If I send this run command, one of them will light up. And you saw that lower one lighting up there. And of course I can also disable it again by sending a false to it. And the whole definition of all of this was supplied to us by this plug and play definition that is built up in the firmware of this device. I can also send a little text to this device. For instance, let's change that here. So I can completely control the device and now I just send hello to the device and that's immediately copied there. What I said already is that, hey, we have the user interface phase up and running here. I can also take a look at all the raw data that has been sent to my device. And what you can see at this thing here is that, hey, that device sends telemetry data every 10 seconds. And then I can take a look at what type of telemetry data is being sent. We send a temperature, pressure, humidity, but we also send things like gyroscope readings. And since the device is not in movement right now, those readings also give us zeros. Accelerometer data. And this is that LED state that I was sending to light up an LED, but I'm not storing that as telemetry data. So this data is not going to be stored for later purposes, for future, you know, like calculations or something. What I also can do is extend the user interface slightly of this particular device if I want to. So for instance, if I want to change the interval, what I can see here is that I have a telemetry interval value, which is defined as a property. Now I'm going to add a little form. And I'm going to call this interval settings. And I'm going to add a property being telemetry interval to this form. So now I created a new little user interface here. I'm going to save that. I'm going to publish this to my IoT Central application. And I just only modified the views there. And now since this is published, I can make use of it. So I go back to this particular device. And now you see that I also have interval settings here. Now what I can do now is, instead of sending data, for instance, every 10 seconds, I can say like, hey, I want to send that data every 60 seconds. I'm going to wait until that value is accepted by our device, which should happen any second. It's accepted now. So it's not entirely new real time, but it's you know, like depending on the speed that I'm depending on my data connection, this goes rather fast. The first time it goes a little bit less fast actually. And if I look now, you can see that my telemetry interval has been just accepted as 60 seconds. If I look at the raw data here, you can also see that, hey, there is this property here where I'm telling that I want to have a telemetry interval of 60 seconds instead of 10 seconds that we had before. And then finally, what you will see is that my telemetry frequency that is still at 10 seconds here will now be modified. And now I will only send data every 60 seconds, so every minute. Now it's going to be a long time to talk through that that minute, I guess. But if I go back here to my commands, for instance, and show that LED one more time, lighting up, you can see that that actually acts pretty fast. And switching it off again, let's take a look at the raw data again. And we see that property change, and I only have 30 seconds left, and then we should see a telemetry update at 142.34 as well. So hopefully that's going to happen. Are there other things I can show here? Yes, there's another important thing I need to show you. I talked to you about data export. So this application can be used for monitoring individual devices. It can also be used to monitor groups of devices. We can connect millions of devices to this solution if we want to. It automatically scales. But I can also export my data, and I can export data to a number of different destinations. I can send it to an event hub, I can send it to some storage, or to a webhook even, you know, like to trigger a web app or something like that. And I can also specify not just destinations, but what type of data I want to export. Probably want to send, you know, like telemetry, but I can also send property changes or device connectivity events where we get information on this device losing its connectivity, for instance. So those exports are used to, you know, like take your data to the next level where you might want to use that data to build AI models, for instance. Let me go back one more time to that telemetry overview here in raw data. And yes, what you see right now is that we brought back the frequency of telemetry data being sent to once every minute. So within 10 minutes, I was able to show you how to connect the device, how that device could send data, how I could modify the device user interface slightly by adding telemetry settings. All thanks to the fact that I'm using an IoT Central application in combination with IoT plug and play that describes how the device is working. So basically, there's not that much more to say than what is actually stopping you from making things happen. Or in other words, yes, try IoT Central, go ahead and you know, like start playing with it and maybe, you know, like build some wonderful solutions with it. It really is not much harder than what I just showed you. And the most important thing there indeed is like, hey, think in problems you want to solve where IoT can be one of the technologies that helps you solve the problem. Now with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and I'm going to open the floor for questions.
Yeah, so there are no questions in the Q&A, but I have some questions that sure. I would like to ask. The first question is, a second here. So the first question is, how should we deal with the material shortages which is occurring currently? Because it seems I just bought the Acer IoT device,
mm-hmm.
and it was 2 months arriving because of the shortage. Just do you know anything about that, or is this something that will be fixed sometime soon?
I'm trying to show myself a bit better. So the availability of the device, is that what you were talking about, or?
Yeah. So the IoT devices, which is from Microsoft, seems to be hard to get because of the chip shortages of materials for creating the chips.
Yeah, that's something. Unfortunately, we don't have that under control, right? The whole market today is suffering from the fact that there is a shortage of chips temporarily, and that might have to do with it actually.
Yeah. Another thing, external tools such as if you want to get data from the environment, which tools would you use? Would you use Microsoft Graph to connect to the
yep.
environment and get the data from there? Or
most of the low code or no code solutions using Graph, you know, like for credential, but also to connect to different services, a very, very valid way to do this. The other one is we have also connectors into Power BI. So if it's really for displaying displaying non-time series data and you know, like learning from the data that you got, and Power BI for visualization is a wonderful tool as well, actually. And yeah, things like Dynamics, again, through Graph, you know, like you can connect properly in that way and easy with low code solutions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But also, and that I want to stress that out as well, is that so from Microsoft solutions, those are today, I would almost say, the preferred way to go. But don't forget, it's not limited to that. I mean, many systems, you know, like our legacy systems, if for instance, you know, like if you look in manufacturing, and many of my customers are actually located in Germany, where they have huge manufacturing industry, we're also capable to connect, you know, like to their legacy systems, if necessary, if those systems, you know, and sometimes those systems have been running for, you know, like 30 years or something, running versions of Windows that, you know, like we hardly remember anymore and that are isolated, but still, you know, like for whatever business reason, they still want to use them. We can connect to that as well. So it can go very, very broad, but no or low code solutions are preferred these days. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So in that, on that path, you would, recommend using some such as Power Automate or Power Platform to utilize different no code solutions.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And what you see there is that we get more and more, what I said, we get more and more connectors to different endpoints. So it's becoming actually really easy. And I'm not, you know, like typically my work kind of stops where the data is getting exported. But let's say it like this, even I am capable of, you know, like building a simple solution at the back end. So it must be easy, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think there is no other question from my end. I don't see any questions from the Icelanders.
Okay.
So I just wanted to mention that this there will be another for the people who is watching this. There will be another lecture on IoT on Friday, which is a real world scenario where we have actually a company that is. Have already set up IoT device and configured it and will give us some in-depth overview on what issues and what to watch out for and so on and so forth. So with that, I don't have any questions. So I just want to thank you for this time you're giving us. And this is a very interesting topic for me, and this is actually my essay for the university, which is Azure IoT. So I'm looking forward to continue and publishing my essay.
Wonderful. Well, good luck with that, and well, thanks everybody for attending. It was a pleasure, and. Well, you know where to find me, so reach out when you have questions, okay?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you very
much.
Bye
for now.
Yeah. Bye-bye.